we may not be together in person, but we still worship together.
Good morning. I want to welcome all of you to the Markham Woods Church live stream. This is actually pre-recorded. This is actually Wednesday afternoon, and Hurricane Ian is bearing down in Orlando. We weren't sure what the results of the damage would be, whether we would have power in the church. So we've recorded this prior to getting hit by Ian, so that for sure we would have something to bless our church membership and all other people that are joining us for a church worship service after this hurricane. So we are glad you can be with us this morning. We do want, again, please do not come into the church. There are no services here at the building. You can access our bulletin online. And for offerings and tithes, remember that you can give online on our website at www.markhamwoodschurch.org. So we're glad you can join us this morning. Let us bow our heads for prayer as we enter this worship service. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you today. And Lord, you are a God that is all-powerful. And yet, sometimes you allow us to go through trials and through storms. So we pray that you will be the God of all comfort for us, that you will bless us this morning as we've come through this hurricane. And Lord, we pray that you will bless those who have been affected by it, for those who have lost loved ones, for those who have lost property or have damage to their property. So Lord, we pray for a special blessing this morning. May your Holy Spirit be here with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Time measured out my days, life carried me along, and in my soul I yearned to follow God, but knew I'd never be so strong. I looked hard at this world to see how heaven could be gained, just to end where I began, where human effort is all in vain. Were it not for grace, expressed with all my heart, offered to the friend who took my place and ran a course I could not start. And when he saw in full just how much his would cost, he still went the final mile between me and heaven, so I would not be lost. Were it not for grace, I can tell you wandering down some pointless road.
As I mentioned before, we are preparing here at the church for Hurricane Ian. Ian is a very powerful storm. It is being broadcast as being historic. By the time you watch this, you will see the results of this powerful force of nature that has come through our state of Florida. It is at times like this, I don't know about you, but I feel my smallness, my weakness, when looking at this incredible force of nature that is being unleashed on the population of humanity. Winds of up to 155 miles an hour, a storm larger than our whole state. And sometimes we start to think apocalyptically when we enter these times of crisis and all of society has to stop work. We have to stop our lives, and then we're left to clean up from the destruction as we examine the toll that it takes on our society. And as Christians, we think apocalyptically at times. And we wonder, is this a sign of the end of times? Does this mean that Jesus is coming back soon? Should we be looking at storms like Ian and other storms that have gone through Florida and ravaged Florida and other parts of America and other natural disasters such as forest fires or tornadoes or earthquakes? We're going to look at this morning the hope of a Christian and what it means when we go through natural disasters. If you have your Bibles at home, you can turn with me to Matthew chapter 24. This is the chapter that Jesus deals with natural disasters such as the one that we just lived through. This is the chapter that Jesus points to the signs of what will occur before he comes back. And we see in the first couple of verses that Jesus actually spurred on the disciples to think apocalyptically. And he mentioned that this beautiful temple in Jerusalem, one of the greatest structures of the world, would one day not be there. And the disciples look at him and probably incredulously ask, well, man, when would this happen? This beautiful, huge structure, when would it be completely gone? And what about the end of the world? So Jesus basically leads his disciples into thinking apocalyptically, into thinking about the end of the world. So if you have your Bibles, let's start in verse 3. And it says that as Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately and they said, tell us, when will this happen? And what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age? Jesus answered, watch out that no one deceives you. For many will come in my name, claiming I am the Messiah, and will deceive many. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you are not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of birth pains. Then you will be handed over to be persecuted and put to death, and you will be hated by all nations because of me. At that time, many will turn away from the faith and will betray and hate each other. And many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. Because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold. But the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations. And then the end will come. Jesus continues later on in the chapter. We'll skip over, if you're following along, to verse 29, where he again picks up the topic of the last days. Immediately after the distress of those days, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from the sky, and the heavenly bodies will be shaken. Then will appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then all the peoples of the earth will mourn when they see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he will send his angels with a loud trumpet call, and they will gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heavens to the other. So Jesus is very clear that there would be signs. Signs that would help us to see that the time is close, that the time is near. What was the first one? We just read it. False prophets, false messiahs. We have plenty of those in the world today. People claiming to have all the answers, leading people away from the Bible, away from an understanding of truth. People that lead people actually away from Christ, away from an understanding of the end of times. Jesus says that's a sign of the end of times. People not understanding prophecy, people not understanding the signs that would surround his coming, that would try to deceive people into either thinking he has come or he won't come. He also mentioned wars, rumors of wars. These have gone on ever since Jesus left about 2,000 years ago. We continue to see that. And now that we have the 24/7 news cycle, we see very clearly how the nations war against each other. Jesus says, do not be alarmed. These must take place. These are signs that I am coming soon. And then he mentions what we're talking about today, famines and earthquakes. That is natural disasters. These are the things that made everybody tremble in those days. A famine when there is no food. Earthquakes when the earth shakes. And for any of you who've ever lived through an earthquake, it's an incredibly unsettling feeling to have the ground, which has normally been so sturdy, not be sturdy. But again, Jesus says, don't worry. These natural disasters, they will happen. They will continue to happen. They are also signs that I am coming soon. And if you look closely in verse 8, he says, these are the beginning of birth pains. So I want to ask the ladies that are watching, what happens as the child gets closer and closer to delivery? Do the pains go away as the child begins to exit the womb? No, they get stronger and stronger until you give birth, until that great, great event of when you see your child come out of your womb. But it's a painful process. Jesus compares these signs to a painful process. And that as he gets closer, it's interesting he chose this analogy, as he gets closer, it seems to imply that they would get stronger and stronger and more things would happen. Now we know that Jesus doesn't cause all bad things in the world. He doesn't cause any bad things in the world. But he allows people to go through this. And he allows Christians to go through this, and he says, don't be alarmed. You must go through them. But know that these are foretelling that another great event will happen, that Jesus will come back. So, but Jesus wasn't done with the signs after natural disasters. And he said, a love of wickedness would overtake the world. Now that word that's translated wickedness in the NIV is the Greek word anomia, which means lawlessness will overtake the world. That is, people will be rebellious. They won't want anybody to tell them what to do. They don't want any law, including God's. But it even implies man's laws as well. Could this be one of the greatest signs? People that are rebellious don't want to submit to each other, to the law, or submit to God. And what does this lead to? Jesus is very clear in this passage. The love of many will grow cold. That is, Jesus implies that we need laws to love each other, that obedience to the law is love for each other. It is love for God. And this is the second to last sign in this passage, along with natural disasters. I think we can see that in our world today. A spirit of rebellion, a spirit of lawlessness, a spirit where people say, I don't want to have anything to do with any government, any church, just leave me alone. And Jesus says, when we do that, the love for each other grows cold. But this last sign is a good sign in verse 14. And Jesus says, you know what? When the gospel gets preached to all the world, then the end will come. So Jesus paints this picture that these signs are occurring, but that the Christian doesn't just sit in a shell and hunker down through all these signs and just complain about the world and how everything is bad. Instead, the Christian looks at these first signs and sees that they're getting more and more common, that the love of many is growing cold, that there are natural disasters, that there are wars, rumors of wars, false prophets that abound in our world. But that they go to the world and preach the gospel, that Jesus has died for them, that Jesus lives to intercede for them, that he was resurrected from the grave, and that he's coming back to take those who walk with him now. Daniel 12, 1 through 3 says this, talking about the time of persecution, which Jesus also alluded to in Matthew chapter 24. And he says this, at that time, Michael, the great prince who protects your people, will arise. There will be a time of distress such as has not happened from the beginning of nations until then. But at that time, your people, everyone whose name is found written in the book, will be delivered. Multitudes who sleep in the dust of the earth will awake, some to everlasting life, others to shame and everlasting contempt. Those who are wise will shine like the brightness of the heavens, and those who lead many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. Isn't that a beautiful picture, church? The world gets darker. The world is wrapped in birth pains. The world is suffering under the weight of wars and famines and earthquakes and natural disasters. The world is suffering from a lack of love and compassion and obedience to the law and having an ordered society. And the Christian stands up because we know Michael is standing up. That is, Jesus is standing up. And because we know Jesus is standing up, we stand up and we shine like lights forever and ever. It's a beautiful picture that we'll be like stars giving light in a world that is dark. Why? Because when the world goes through a tunnel of darkness, we see the light at the end of the tunnel. And we reflect it, and we shine. And what is that end of the tunnel? Jesus said it to his disciples very clearly in John 14, 1 through 3. Don't let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Jesus understood we'll have problems. I don't know what problems you're facing. If you live in Central Florida or the western coast of Florida or anywhere in our state, actually, you may have had your houses damaged. You may have been injured or even lost a loved one or a friend. However, Jesus says, don't let your hearts be troubled. I've gone away, and I've prepared a house where there are no natural disasters. I will come back and take you to be where I am. It's an incredible comfort that the Christian has, that even though we face death and destruction, which we see in the wake of storms like Ian, in the wake of forest fires, in the wake of earthquakes, in the wake of terrible wars. That is why he told us to watch for these signs, to watch for them like we watch for the seasons of the year. Yes, he said in that chapter, we won't know the day or the hour. We won't know exactly when it's going to happen, but we will know the season. And we will know that it's getting closer and closer. Peter talks about what difference this makes for the Christian. If you have your Bibles, you can turn with me to 2 Peter chapter 3. And Peter warns about groups of people that scoff at this hope that we have of the second coming. Above all, you must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. That is just what Jesus talked about. Lawlessness, just following whatever they want to do. They will say, where is this coming that he promised? Ever since our ancestors died, everything goes on as it has since the beginning of creation. But they deliberately forget that long ago, by God's word, the heavens came into being and the earth was formed out of water and by water. By these waters also, the world of that time was deluged and destroyed. By the same word, the present heavens and earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything in it will be laid bare. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? That is, Peter wants to draw a conclusion talking about the second coming. You ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming. That day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire and the elements melt in the heat. But in keeping with his promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth where righteousness dwells. Peter says we have this promise. We're looking for a new land. The earth will be dark. But we have the incredible privilege, church, to live godly, holy lives and to speed up the second coming of Jesus. We do not have to just relax and say, well, it'll happen someday. Who knows when it'll happen? You see, if you combine Peter and Jesus, you can say that when we go through something like Hurricane Ian, it can increase our desire, our longing for home, our longing to be with Jesus, our longing to be somewhere where there's no more death, no more suffering, no more sin, no more lawlessness, where we won't have to lock our doors, where we won't have to put cardboard on our windows, where we won't have to worry about electricity going out. That day is coming soon. What a beautiful privilege we have as Christians to go through trials and to look forward to this great day. During his 1960 presidential campaign, John F. Kennedy often closed his speeches with the story of Colonel Davenport, the Speaker of the Connecticut House of Representatives. On May 19, 1780, the sky of Hartford darkened ominously, and some of the representatives, glancing out the windows, feared the end was at hand. Quelling a clamor for immediate adjournment, Davenport rose and said, "The day of judgment is either approaching or it is not. If it is not, there is no cause for adjournment. If it is, I choose to be found doing my duty. Therefore, I wish that candles be brought." End of quote. You see, this was a sign, actually talked about in Matthew 24, of the sky being darkened, the sun not giving its light, a sign of the end of the world. And yet Colonel Davenport does not get afraid. He does not say, wait a minute, the end of the world is here. I'm going to go hunker down and just quiver in fear. He says, no, if it is the end of the world, I will stay true to my duty. I will continue to shine my light. Folks, I'm going to put up an Adventist artist rendition of the second coming that we have in our foyer at Markham Woods Church. A beautiful painting that depicts why we call ourselves Seventh-day Adventists. A day that we should never lose from our view. A day that we should remember. The Apostle Paul says, talk about this day, encourage one another. When the archangel of the Lord shall come down and the trumpet shall sound and the dead in Christ will rise first, and they shall rise along with us who are left, who are remaining, to be with Jesus forever. I don't know where you are right now and what you've gone through. If you're not in Florida, it's not like we have the market on natural disasters or disasters overall where people suffer. But if you're in Central Florida, you probably spent the last few days in a position or a place that you would rather not have been. It's suffering. You may have had to do a lot of cleanup. You may have had to comfort someone. But I want to encourage you this morning that as the cloudy skies darken in the world and all of these signs are occurring, lack of love, war, rumors of wars, natural disasters, false prophets, lawlessness, I pray that you will continue to be an Adventist, that you will have that hope burning brightly in your soul, and that you will continue to shine your light until that great day when Jesus comes back to take us home. May God bless us. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for the promise of your soon coming. We thank you that you do not want us to be troubled, that there is light at the end of the tunnel, and that you are patient with all of us, and that you want all to come to repentance. Lord, I pray that we will be light in our not only our community, but also in the whole world. May you continue to bless us and guide us. We pray all these things in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen.